Can you see my screen?
Yes, Priyat, you can.
Hello and welcome to the first Journal Club of the year 2021. Joining us as panelists today, we have Professor Priyanka Ranasinghe, Professor of Pharmacology, Faculty of Medicine, University of Colombo, and Dr. Dilshani Disanayake, Director of the Research, Promotion and Facilitation Center, and Senior Lecturer of the Department of Physiology, Faculty of Medicine, University of Colombo. We are very privileged to have you both here joining us in this discussion. So the paper that we have selected for today's Journal Club, the title is Temporal Changes in Emotional Intelligence Among Medical Undergraduates, a 5-year follow-up study. So this has been conducted. The first author of the study, we are fortunate enough to have been joining with us to discuss, to critically analyze this study. So there are several reasons as to why we chose this study for our Journal Club today. One, as the title itself says, is that this is a follow-up study, and that is actually a little different from the cross-sectional studies that most of us are used to. And another important thing that you'll see in the coming slides is that this entire study has been conducted online. So that is also another interesting aspect. I think most of you would be interested, especially with the pandemic going around, most of the research activities would have to be restricted to that online scenario. So we hope to build up an ongoing discussion and learn more regarding these aspects. So before we move on with the discussion, I would like to give some instructions as to how this discussion will go on. Similar to the previous Journal Club, this will happen in a question and answer format. So I hope that all the participants who have joined with us today would join in on the discussion. You can either unmute yourself and provide answers, or you can give your answers in the chat box. Either way is fine. So to stimulate, I think the best way to learn is to contribute to this discussion rather than being passive. I think in the coming slides, I hope to see like everybody participating in this discussion. Before moving on with the discussion, I would like to invite Professor Priyanka, who is the first author of this study, to give us a brief description about this study as to like what emotional intelligence is, because I know it's not a very familiar concept to us. Everybody is familiar with the intelligence quotient, which measures the level of intelligence, but emotional intelligence is actually a different concept. And then why emotional intelligence would be important among medical students, and also how the current MBBS program would help to elevate the level of emotional intelligence among students. So over to you, sir.
Right, thank you, Priyat. Very happy to be joining you all. I hope my sound is heard clearly.
Yes, sir, we can hear.
Good afternoon to you all. It's still morning where I am joining from. First of all, very happy about the initiatives that you have taken with regards to sort of promoting research culture among the medical students, which is, I think, requirement, because if you see in other countries, even from student period, they start straight away engage in research, and by the time they pass out, most of them have research publications and so on. Unfortunately, that culture is still not there in Sri Lanka. And then the problem that we face is once you all pass out and go to the health ministry, we don't see you all doing any productive research. I mean, people do research, but then it's only very, very limited. But for that to be corrected, the research culture has to be inculcated in students while they are in the faculty. So I'm very happy that you have taken the step, and I can tell you at the outset that you all have my fullest support. So getting on to the topic. So why we did this research? Now, if you take intelligence, now we know that intelligence, there are several domains. Now, traditionally, maybe about 40, 50 years ago, people were talking about the IQ as a measurement of intelligence. But later on, people realized that intelligence is not a domain that can only be measured by IQ. There are other components. So emotional intelligence is one such area. Now, it simply means how you deal with emotions of yourself and of others. That is what emotional intelligence is. So it is going beyond simple in IQ, what is measured by IQ. So which is important, we know as now, not only in medical students or as doctors or professionals, wherever we work now, once we graduate from university, we go into the working environment and then we are exposed to other people. So as medical professionals, we have to deal with patients. We are exposed to patients, their relatives, we have colleagues, right? We work in a very stressful environment, right? So the components of emotional intelligence, now there are several domains that had been defined, like self-awareness, self-management, relationship management, social awareness. These components are very important for a normal person, but when it comes to a medical personnel, they are very more important probably because of what I just mentioned, the fact that we have to deal with patients and relatives. Not only that, we have to deal with a whole set of colleagues, like not only doctors, you have the nurses, the attendants, then the other support staff, a lot of people we have to deal with, and in a very stressful environment. Manage when you start practicing, you will see as house officers, as doctors, you are always constantly dealing with patients, problems and all that. So and then you have your personal life, your family life and all that. So you need to be able to manage your emotions and to recognize the emotions of others, right? So that is why emotional intelligence is important, and measuring emotional intelligence also important. And the other thing about emotional intelligence, although we consider IQ generally to be a static construct, generally IQ doesn't change much in a person's life, right? But emotional intelligence can be changed. So if you have with learning, with experience, with teaching, behavioral interventions, so a person's emotional intelligence can be improved. So that is the good thing about it. So because it is not static, if somebody is having poor emotional intelligence now, either by practice alone or by education, teaching and behavioral interventions, the person's emotional intelligence can be improved, right? So that is the good thing about it. So when it comes to the medical curriculum, there, you know, you may be in different stages, maybe in first year, second year, third year, I don't know, but you know that there are certain components in the faculty teaching which we try to inculcate you in the form of medical humanities, right? Which is, although not directly dealing with emotional intelligence, those inputs are also important to improve the emotional intelligence of the person. So what we wanted to see in this particular study was to see whether the emotional intelligence of our students improve over time, right? And although we couldn't directly measure the impact of the educational interventions or medical humanities or behavioral science or whatever, that was the whole idea, to see whether there is a change in emotional intelligence. So that is the whole background and that is the whole idea of this project.
Thank you very much, sir. So I think now most of us would understand why emotional intelligence is crucial for a medical student. It's essential for other roles as well, but for a medical student, it is very important in order to carry out both the academic activities as well as the future clinical practice also. So with that background in mind, let's move on to the next step, the research question. We all know when reading a research paper, the first step should be actually to identify what the research question is. What is this question that the authors have tried to investigate? So therefore, I would like to ask from the audience, what is the research question that the authors have tried to answer from this study? You can either unmute yourself and give the answer or you can use the chat box. But I would like if everybody would actively participate in this discussion. So if you can unmute and answer, that would be great. If I were to provide a hint, usually the research question is stated towards in the introduction paragraph of an article towards the end of it, if I were to provide a hint.
I think determine the change of the emotional intelligence over a period of time, and also identifying the factors that contribute or that correlate with that change of emotional intelligence. in medical undergraduates in our faculty? I think that's the research question.
Thank you, Nisal. Yes, I think those are the two main objectives. It's given in the paper, if you look at the introduction section, towards the end. One is to, like he mentioned, to assess the change, the temporal change in emotional intelligence, because Priyanka mentioned, emotional intelligence is usually not static. So therefore, the authors have tried to identify the change in emotional intelligence over a period of 5 years. That's one objective. And the other one is to try and find the factors that are associated with this change in emotional intelligence. So these are the basic objectives of this study. Now let's see, through this discussion, let's see whether the authors have used the appropriate methods to identify, to satisfy these objectives, and also what were their findings related to these objectives. Next, another important thing is when conducting a study, it is essential to pick an appropriate setting. We should be able to justify as to why we are carrying out, because we will be having a research question, but in order to answer that question, we might be able to use several settings. So it is up to the investigators to select an appropriate setting for this particular study. Hence, my next question from this audience is, what is the justification for carrying out this study in the selected setting? So the setting is, like I mentioned before, it has been carried out in our very own faculty, Faculty of Medicine, University of Colombo. So what is the justification for selecting this particular this particular setting in order to carry out this study? Would someone like to answer?
Priyat, like you noted earlier, this is a follow-up study. So which means that I think that the study population that is selected in the follow-up study must be available throughout the duration of the study. And I think one of the best places where students actually are staying for a very long period of time is actually the medical faculty. So because of that, I think this is an actually very suitable and appropriate study setting.
Thank you, Afra. Yes, I think that would be very true. As we all know, we are engaged in this curriculum, and since this is a follow-up study, one of the very important things is to retain the participants until the end of the study. It's not unlike in a cross-section study where you would interact with the participants only once, collect the data, and that's the end of the study. But in a follow-up study, we would have to retain the participants. And I think this medical faculty would be the ideal place in order to capture, in order to measure these changes over a period of 5 years. Sir, would you like to add anything to that?
Yeah, I think I explained to Priyat the other day. So originally, actually speaking, we did not, now usually when you conduct a proper follow-up study, at the beginning, you plan for the entire follow-up and what you want to do and what you want to achieve. In that sense, I have to be frank with you, this was actually not initially proposed to be a follow-up study. If you look at, if you had gone through the original article, you would see we had done a similar study 5 years ago as a cross-sectional study, right? Where we recruited students from the second year, second, third, and final year, if I remember. And we did a cross-sectional study to see whether the emotional intelligence differs between these different batches. That was the original idea when we started this project, right? But at the end of the day, we thought, okay, now one of the problems we encountered was now in that particular cross-sectional study also, we could say whether the third year students' emotional intelligence was better than the first year. Whether the final year students' emotional intelligence was better than the first year. So using that study design also, we could have answered this question. I hope you get my point. What I'm trying to tell you is, to answer a particular research question, there is no single study method. You can answer a question using multiple methods, right? So the cross-sectional study design also could have been used to answer this particular question, is there a change? But the problem there is, what we are comparing is different groups. So the first year, third year, fifth year, although they are in different years, they are from different groups. So that is not the best design to see whether there is a temporal change, right? So the thing that you have to understand is, although a same question can be answered with multiple methods, you have to select the best method, right? So that is why we thought, okay, now after 5 years, we will repeat the emotional intelligence assessment and see whether there is an actual change with time in the same group, right? So as I think Afra mentioned, the best setting for this is the faculty, because the loss to follow-up is minimal because the students are there for a long time. And for something like emotional intelligence to see a change, you have to give sufficient time. I mean, there is no point in checking emotional intelligence today and rechecking it after another 1 year, right? Because that is not sufficient time. It would have been ideal if we had a further longer time period, maybe 10 years. But then the practical problems come in, where the people will not be available for follow-up. Now, even if you look at this study, there is a certain dropout rate. And if you read the results, you will realize that those dropped out students are the foreign students who during the time of the study has gone back to their country, right? So when organizing a follow-up study, one of the important things that you have to keep in mind is how do you try plan to retain this population and ensure that you get adequate data during follow-up, because at the end of the day, there is a large dropout rate, you are not going to get the valid result, right? So keeping both these factors in mind only, we selected this particular study.
Thank you, sir. So I think it would be very important to ensure that follow-up is carried out properly. In a cross-sectional study, we are focused with the response rate. Similarly, in a follow-up study such as this, it is essential to retain most of the participants. Otherwise, the findings that we generate through this study will not actually represent the actual scenario. Okay, then
Now this is only a 5-year follow-up study.
Yes.
If you go in the literature, medical literature, there are very, very long-term follow-up studies going on for 25, 30 years. There you will see even the investigators have changed. The investigators have died and so on. So the original investigators are conducting the follow-up. That is also possible, but those are then conducted by the institution. So the institutional has the say in ensuring the follow-up and continuity.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Then let's move on to analyzing the methodology of this study. And we know that in a research, the methodology is actually like the heart of the research. If there's something wrong in the methodology section, then that would affect the entire research. Then the results that we generate would be wrong and we will be making wrong conclusions. So therefore, we will now critically look at the methodology that is used in this paper. We start with the study design. And now I think we did actually talk a bit about the study design. Now, again, just to refresh, I would like to ask someone from the audience what the study design is. It's mentioned in the methodology section. You can unmute and answer, or you can put it in the chat box.
Here, the study design is a prospective follow-up study of 5 years.
Yes, thank you. So yes, as Sheila rightly mentioned, it's a prospective follow-up study. So there are two types of studies, prospective and retrospective. Retrospective means the outcome has already happened and you're looking back in time. But here, this is a prospective study, means initially the cohort was recruited and then they were followed up forward in time. So it is a prospective follow-up study. Then I would like to ask, what are the advantages? I think Professor Priyanka also explained, what are the other advantages of using a longitudinal study design as opposed to a cross-sectional study? Now, sir also mentioned that both study designs could have been used to answer this question, but each has its own limitations. But we know, especially in our community medicine research, what we are most often told is that when we are using cross-sectional studies, we are not capable of finding risk factors. And we are not capable of establishing any cause and effect relationship. Because in a cross-sectional study, both the outcome as well as the effect is measured at the same point in time. So, sir, would you be able to give us some insight onto the advantages of a longitudinal study as opposed to a cross-sectional study? Would it be possible to measure risk factors? Would it be possible to establish a cause and effect relationship?
Yeah, so one of the, as you said, Priyat, one of the main disadvantages of a cross-sectional study is the fact that we are measuring both at the same time. Now, when you are trying to answer a research question, there are so many factors that you have to take into account. One thing is the study design, what is the best way to answer this question? But then there are other things that also come into play. The practicality of that particular method that you have selected. Do we have adequate funding? Do we have adequate resources? So sometimes when you take everything into account, the cross-sectional study design may probably be the most suitable in that particular setting to answer the question. Now your community research is a classic example. Now your research questions that you generate could have been jolly well answered by other better study designs. But what limits you from conducting those studies is that you have practical limitations. You have limitations in time, you have limitations in funding, you have limitations in resources available, right? So the study design is not only based on the best design to answer the question. Sometimes other factors also come into play in selecting the most suitable study design that you have to keep in mind, right? And then you have to also consider advantages as well as disadvantages. Now, if you consider a longitudinal follow-up study, as Priyat said, the advantage will be the cause and effect relationship can be better established through that. But the problem is the disadvantage may be the extensive resources that are required for conducting. Now this, of course, was a straightforward thing. Single questionnaire, that is fine. But then if it is a large scale follow-up study for some disease or risk factor, you will need a lot of resources for the follow-up to ensure, and then you will need to ensure that the patients are retained. People, if it is conducted in the community, people move from one place to another, right? Their locations change. So you need an extensive set of resources. So you need to balance the benefit versus the risk or the advantages versus the disadvantages when selecting the appropriate study design. So that is to answer the question about how do you select the study design. Now remember, again, I'm saying study design selection is not only based on the best study design to answer the question. You have to take into account the other practical factors as well. That is one. Then when considering the follow-up study, yes, the follow-up to answer this particular question, whether there is a change with time, the longitudinal study design would be the best because we are following up the same cohort with the same characteristics. Now, you know, if you take as I said earlier, this question could have been answered by taking a cross-sectional design, which we did earlier, and looking at first years, third years, and fifth years, right? But then it is not the same cohort. And then because we know for constructs like emotional intelligence, a lot of other factors also come into play. So that is not the best way to answer this question, right? That is why the longitudinal study design is good, suitable to answer this question because we monitor the same cohort during this particular time period, who has been exposed to same, more or less the same educational experience, more or less the same clinical experience. So that is the advantage. The same cohort, when you go through time, we can assume that they are exposed to the same environment, same factors that contributed to the change, right? Of course, the disadvantages I already mentioned. You have to
based on the things sir said, we have to come into a decision as to what the most optimal study design would be. Maybe not the best study design to answer that question, but the optimal study design considering the advantages and the disadvantages as well. Next, I would like to ask, the question I would like to ask is, what are the key things that we should focus on when planning a follow-up study? Because I think a study that is similar to the one that we are looking at today, which has been conducted online, and also maybe at the other extreme, maybe a randomized clinical trial, that is also, I think, a form of a follow-up study because patients who are receiving different treatments are followed up over a period of time. Maybe let's say 5 years, 5 years, maybe even more. So if we make a mistake in the beginning, and then we are halfway through, then there's no way that we can correct that mistake. We can't go back in time. So therefore, are there any very important essential things that we should be focusing on when planning a follow-up study? Madam, can you give us some thoughts regarding this?
Yes, Priyanka. Now I'm enjoying your discussion. Well done, you're doing well. So the main issue in follow-up study is having your cohort. You have to select the cohort carefully. So you have to decide on what you're looking for and also to get your sample refined. And then you are actually assessing the same cohort. Now, some of your, you know, if you have an objective to achieve and if that can be achieved by a cross-sectional study, as we discussed, then we don't have to do a follow-up. And even in this study, now, if you give the questionnaire to the whole batch and if you have about 150 respondents, and then you have to retain that 150 and to assess them longitudinally. So that is, though it may look like a, you know, simple, easy study, still to have that same cohort is difficult. So in when there are larger studies where they look at cause and effect of diseases also, maintaining that cohort and selecting that cohort is important. And as Professor Priyanka said, look at the practical aspect of it. Let's say we are introducing an intervention. Now, usually for an intervention, you have a control group as well as a sample or a patient group or a group whom we are studying our intervention on. So to the best method probably is to have a randomized selection. So you have to randomize your control as well as the sample. Sometimes it becomes difficult. So there are things that you need to think of. You know, you have to think of your objectives and your outcomes and see how you can achieve your outcomes. And you have to make sure that the selection, mainly the sample and the control that you have selected and the method of selecting the control and sample is perfect. Otherwise, at the end, you can, as you said, go back and change that. And also to look at... Hello, can you hear me?
Hello. Yes, madam. Thank you.
All right, I think something happened. So, so I think one, now we will select a randomized control trial one day and we'll discuss intervention studies in detail that way. But as you said, if you're looking at a simple longitudinal follow-up study, the main thing is to see the sample that you have selected, you know, is the correct sample for you all to achieve the outcome or the objective that you have, or the research question, whether you can find the answer to the research question based on the sample that you have achieved. So you have to have a very good understanding of the sample. And then you have to decide how you are going to follow up. And then there you have to look at the practicality of it, how you are going to do your assessment, and also that there is no bias in your assessment. So as Professor Priyanka says, sometimes the investigator changes, but you have to make sure that there is no bias between the investigators as well. So lots of things are there when you're actually planning a follow-up. So make the best way is to write a good proposal and then go through the proposal to see how practical and how doable it is to do the follow-up study.
Thank you, madam. You gave a lot of practical advice for actually starting a study like this. Then we'll move on to, as I mentioned before, the study has been conducted online. So how this is different from a traditional study is that once data collection is completed, then the rest of the things such as data analysis and writing the report, the discussion, those will be very similar in both online research as well as traditional studies. But the main key thing that is different is in an online study is the data collection and the factors that are evolving around that. So we would like to, like, since we are also new to this field of online research, we would like to ask Professor Priyanka, what are the important aspects to be considered when conducting an online study, like as opposed to a normal traditional study? Are there some important aspects that we have to be careful when carrying out an online study, especially with regard to data collection?
Yeah, so before I come to this online study design, one thing as students or researchers who are in the earlier stages of your career, one of the important things that you have to realize is that, as Dilshani correctly said, is that you need to plan your study very, very carefully. I would say if you take the research proposal, for me, actually, the most important section in the research proposal is the methodology section. That is where things can go wrong. And I mean, we have had many instances. Dilshani also probably can say have examples of this, where after conducting the research and after collecting the data, they come and ask us in the analysis to do some sort of analysis to answer the research question. But we see that the data has not been corrected properly. I can show you an example just to highlight this, a diagram, right? Let me share the screen.
You can share, sir.
Yeah, just this diagram summarizes everything I said. You have to make sure that your research hypothesis is matching with the objectives, and objective is are matching with the methods. So one of the many problems we see among student researchers, not in only students, even senior researchers, where the objectives are not matching with the data collection methods, right? So when that happens, when they come and ask us, okay, we have collected the data, now we want to answer this question, research question, we are in difficulty, or that person will be in difficulty, because they have not collected the appropriate data to answer the question. So this is a very important thing. Otherwise, at the end of the day, you will be shaking the tree and ending up with only the leaves and not the fruit, right? So one of the important things, not only for follow-up studies, for any study, make sure your objectives are matching with the methods that you are measuring, whatever that you have stated in the objectives, to answer the research question in an appropriate way, right? That is an important thing, right? Coming back to online research. So now, online research, one of the main differences is that now you are most probably you are physically not meeting the study participants, right? So then the questions arises, okay, first contact point, how do we contact the study participants? Then the second question, once we contact them, how do we get their informed written consent? And then finally, after they have consented, how do we collect the data, right? So now I will just go through what we did in this particular project, right? Now, of course, in this project, we had a collaborator from the particular medical student batch. There is an author who is from that batch. So that made life easier, right? So what we did here was that we contacted them through either telephone, because that student had all the numbers, or we contacted them through the student's official email address. Right, that is the initial point of contact, right, where we sent them the information sheet. Now, you know that when you conduct research, you need to have the information sheet and so on. One thing that made life easier in this research was, since the group was medical students, our data collection tool and the information sheet and consent forms all were in English. We didn't need to translate them to Sinhala or Tamil or whatever, because it was reasonable to assume that all students at the end of 5 years are competent enough to answer questions and read English and understand English, right? So we emailed them the information sheets and then the consent forms, and they were supposed to send it back to us after filling. Of course, we had to use the e-signature for this purpose. Some of the other methods that people use in online surveys is actually online or distant surveys. They send it through post, right? They contact by telephone, and then the questionnaire, information sheet, consent forms are sent through post with an envelope, with a stamp, self-addressed back to you, so that the person who is receiving doesn't have to spend any money. They can fill the questionnaire, put it in the envelope, and send it back to you. right? Those are some of the methods that have been used. In fact, I was part of a study that was done in Oxford on sexual dysfunction, which was entirely done to telephones. I was not involved in data collection, but what they did was they contacted the participants through telephone. And then those who agreed initially verbally through telephones got the consent forms information sheets through post. And then the self-address envelopes were there and they could send back, right? But that was a very large survey, about 5,000 participants were there. So even large-scale studies can be done through that way. But nowadays, life is simpler because most of the people are online and electronic signatures and things are there and they are accepted and valid. So that makes life easier, right? Then once they have given the consent, of course, then the requirement was for data collection. Again, we designed a Google form and sent to their official faculty email address and got them to fill the form. Now, the problems that can arise here is that how do we ensure that the correct person is filling? How do we ensure that the same person does not fill twice, right? So those are the security checks that you need to have when you are filling an online questionnaire. So one thing that we did, of course, these are not foolproof, right? Something that we did in this one was we required the participants to use the official email address when filling the questionnaire, right? A sort of a sign-in-like thing. And then we ensured that the email addresses are not duplicated. So the same person cannot enter the same email address twice and fill the questionnaire twice, right? So you have to ensure those kind of methods to prevent other people filling the questionnaire, right? That is why we send the email to the official email address and to prevent duplication. But I agree that some of these things are not 100% foolproof, right? So those are other practical problems that you will encounter. Another method where people conduct distance survey is through telephone, where you fill the questionnaire by asking the questions over the phone, right? Once you have got the consent, maybe either through email or through post, you can do a telephone survey and ask them the questions. So these are methods of distant data collection. But it is very important, especially is to ensure that you get an adequate response, that you have somebody from that group, right? For example, let's say you wanted to collect data from University of Jaffna, right? Okay, let's say I wanted to do the same study in the final year medical students in Jaffna, right? Do you think that I would get the same response rate if I followed the same methodology? I contacted, let's say, the dean's office in Jaffna, got the official email addresses, sent them emails, right? Do you think I will get the same response rate? Most probably not. Most probably not, because that same level of personal contact or follow-up is not there. So then the best method to do is I need to retain a collaborator or somebody who is willing to help me with the data collection in that local study setting, right? So those are the practical things that you have to keep in mind, because at the end of the day, your interest is you need the particular sample size for your data to be valid, for you to get sufficient interpretation, right? So to ensure that, certain practical methods will need to be employed.
Thank you very much for this valuable advice, because I think that will be very useful for most of us in the audience today also, because of this pandemic that is going around. Most of the research activities will be limited to an online scenario, at least for the following months to come, because of
somebody asked me, there is a question in the chat. Minul has asked online service. Yes, you can actually, now we know we fill online forms and we agree to the terms and conditions. And then even electronic, some electronic things, they accept the email as the electronic signature. So those things are also acceptable. If somebody, if you provide the information sheet online and then the consent form, and then if you ask the participant, okay, you by putting your official email address in this particular box, you are agreeing to consent to participate in these studies. In this day of electronic age, those things are okay.
Okay, thank you, sir.
So, yes, I think Minura is correct, because now there are so many emails coming with the Google Sheets, Google Forms, and you have a small introduction in the email and then you have to fill the form. So for the large surveys, you may not get a form to sign and to email back, but the fact that you clicked on it implies that you have given consent. So yes, you're correct.
Thank you, madam. Then looking at the questionnaires that have been used in this study, because questionnaires, as we all know, are vital for carrying out research. We need to collect data, and in order to collect data, we use questionnaires. So now I would like to ask someone in the audience, what is the tool? Now there are a lot of dependent and independent variables that have been studied. What is the tool that was used to measure emotional intelligence among the medical undergraduates? Because that has been the main focus of this research, to measure the emotional intelligence along a period of time. So what is the tool or the questionnaire that was used to measure emotional intelligence? Would someone like to answer? You can either unmute or say, or ISVC in the chat box. Yes, it's a SHUT self-report intelligence test. And that is actually, if you read the article, you would understand that it is a validated tool for measuring emotional intelligence. Now we come across several validated tools. And what is this meaning of a validated tool? And why is it necessary to use? Can't we just use a questionnaire that has been developed by the investigators themselves? Sir, would you like to give your thoughts regarding this as to why it is? Is it essential to use a validated tool? If we need to, let's say, if we are to publish the findings of our study, is it necessary for us to have used validated tools, or can we use some other questionnaires that the investigators themselves have developed?
Yeah, so now when you are measuring something, like let's say in this instance, emotional intelligence, but in some research studies, let's say maybe you are trying to diagnose diabetes, for example. So whatever that you are trying to measure, the measurement should be valid. Now we know if it is, if we are trying to diagnose diabetes, for example, we know that there are valid criteria, valid methods, valid tests to diagnose that, right? Once we do the test, if it is above a certain value, we know that the person is having diabetes. If it is not, we know that the patient is non-diabetic, right? Now, in certain instances, things like emotional intelligence, we now obviously there is no single test to measure, right? And it is a continuum. There is no cutoff to say somebody is emotionally intelligent and somebody is not. It is a continuum, right? So then in those instances, we have to use a questionnaire to assess the emotional intelligence. Now, things like emotional intelligence, where there are multiple areas. I explained to you, emotional intelligence is not a single construct. There are multiple dimensions, self-awareness, relationship awareness, self-management. There are multiple dimensions. So in those kind of constructs, when there are multiple dimensions, you cannot get an answer to whether somebody is emotional intelligent or not by a simple yes no question. So then you need a questionnaire where you have multiple questions that will assess these different constructs or different areas, right? Or different paradigms or whatever, right? So if you want to do that, there are two methods you can go about it. Okay, you know that emotional intelligence has multiple dimensions. So you can design your own questions to address these dimensions. For each dimension, maybe you design 5 questions or whatever. And then you can use that particular tool for your study. But the problem is all these research tools or research questionnaires, they have their limitations, right? If you use your own tool straight away for the study without doing a proper validation, you don't know whether your tool is valid. You don't know whether your tool is reliable and so on, right? So then it would be better if you can find a validated tool. where the previous authors who originally developed the questionnaire has done that for you, right? They have developed, not only developed the questionnaire, they have assessed whether the questionnaire is reliable, whether the questionnaire is valid, right? Now there are different methods to do that, right? That is entirely a different discussion. So questionnaire development and validation is a separate research. So if you want to develop your own questionnaire for this, now in this project, if there was no questionnaire to assess emotional intelligence, the best way to would have been for me to ask to develop a questionnaire. That in itself is a different research, because questionnaire validation involves a lot of steps, right? So then you need to go back to the literature and find out, are there validated tools? Because by using a validated tool, you can assume that you are getting your measurement reliably, because you want to ensure at the end of the day, the final measurement of emotional intelligence, the measurement that you are getting is reliable and valid, because that is the variable you are going to compare with other variables. If your measurement is invalid, then there is a problem. So that is why you need to select a validated tool. Then the question of how you select the validated tool. Now, if you go back and dig up in the literature to measure emotional intelligence, there would be many tools. So how do you select? That is another question. So then you have to consider the study design, the setting, the practical issues. Is the questionnaire that I am selecting the most appropriate for my particular cohort, right? For example, now you have to balance again. You may have a questionnaire which has only 5 questions. So in that sense, that is very easy for the participants. They are more likely to fill it accurately, right? But then in those kind of questionnaires, the reliability and the validity may be less. You may have a questionnaire with 100 questions, which will most likely have a higher validity and reliability, right? So it is a matter of balancing what is the most suitable for this particular population. And then now in this instance, this particular questionnaire was only available in English. So for the particular cohort, that was acceptable, because we can assume the medical students final year competent enough in English. But if we were to translate this questionnaire into Sinhala and Tamil, again, then we will have to do what you call a validation of the translation. Now, the original questionnaire, remember, has been validated in English. So if you are to translate, although you are translating the same questionnaire, once you change the wordings or the language, the meanings change. So ideally, if you are using a translated questionnaire, the translated questionnaire also will need to go through a process of validation before you use. So that you have to keep in mind, right? So the first thing is selecting the most suitable questionnaire, the most suitable to measure what you are trying to get, and the most suitable for the population. Second thing is, do you need to do a translation? And if so, you will need to validate the translation as well.
Thank you, sir. So I think we would have gotten a very clear idea about that entire validation, how to measure certain constructs that cannot be measured objectively. For example, as in this research, emotional intelligence. So how to develop...
Priya, find out whether you have understood clearly, I'm going to ask you a question. Now you have got a validated tool which has been validated, let's say in USA.
Yes, ma'am.
You, now when you're doing your study, let's say combat study, you need to assess something and you found a tool which has been validated in, usually they are validated in either America or in Western countries. And are you going to directly use that, or what are the problems that you might encounter if that has been validated, tested for, you know, reliability, repeatability, and also sensitivity, everything is perfect, right? So what are the problems? Are you going to use it directly? What are the things that you will think about before using that tool?
I think mainly because, just like Sir mentioned, since that has been validated in an American population, there the cultural context would be different if we are going to use it in Sri Lanka, even if we are not translating it and we are thinking of administering it in English. Even then, I think we would have to maybe re-perform a validation study, because the cultural context and the construct that we are measuring, that may be different in the two populations. So I think we would need a validation study. And apart from that, if you would have to translate it into maybe, let's say, Sinhala or Tamil, then again, that would definitely require another linguistic validation for this study, for this questionnaire.
Excellent. Excellent answer. That's what I was looking for. I think we'll need to discuss simply about validating questionnaires and what are the different steps that we can we have to go through when we are validating. We'll do another session on that. But I think you've got the idea. So good.
Yeah, you got the point. Yes. So just to add to that. So what you just described is what is known as cultural adaptation. Sometimes in the cultural adaptation process, if you are only changing maybe one or two questions, then it is up to the research team. Of course, the research team, you expect to be experts in that particular area that you are conducting the research. Then the research team can decide, okay, we only change few minor things, not the language even, just cultural context. Then you don't need to do an entire validation study. You just can do the cultural adaptation and use the same tool. But if you are doing major changes, then of course you will have to go for a proper validation, which needs an entire separate session to discuss.
Yeah. So what Priyanga suggested was to do a face validity. That is something that we do. If you are doing minor changes, you get a Delphi group or expert group and go through the changes and validate it. And we call it face validity, and that's acceptable. Okay.
Thank you, madam. Thank you. And I think it would be very useful to have a session at a late date about this validation, because that is not something that is taught us directly in our undergraduate curriculum under the research component of community medicine. So I think it would be very interesting to have such a session about the whole new aspects of validation and testing for reliability. So in the future, we will hope to bring a session. So stay tuned for that. Then I would like to move on.
Priyat, I have a question.
Yes.
Yeah. Madam, sir, when we are using a questionnaire, let's say there is a questionnaire that is for for, let's say, quality of life, there is a generic score scale for common children. And also there are questionnaires with a particular disease type for each children. Each diseases, there are questionnaires. So, for the same thing, quality of life. So when we were doing a research, we had an issue like there was a quality of life score scale for diabetes for children was there, but that was not linguistically validated in our setup. But we had a questionnaire where there was a linguistic validation of the questionnaire. It was the quality of life, but not disease specific. But at the end, we decided to go with the non-disease specific quality of life questionnaire, since that has cultural adaptation. So in cases, in conditions like that, how to make such decisions like disease specific questionnaires and having common questionnaires for concepts like quality of life?
Yes, Priyanga, shall I answer or are you going to ask?
Shani, go ahead. Yeah.
Okay, now, very good. You have decided correctly, because in the end, as you all discussed, methodology is important. And the method that you have followed, it has to be a valid method. So if you have found a questionnaire, which was general for the pediatric population, which was assessing quality of life, and you use that, and if you achieved your objective, it's mainly based on what you wanted to achieve. So if you wanted to achieve the objective that you wanted to achieve was to assess the quality of life in this group of children. And if you achieve that objective, I think it's okay to use that. But if you wanted to assess the quality of life, a disease-specific quality of life, then it has to be a big study, because you have to validate the existing questionnaire. If you think that is suitable for our population and it needs validation, if it needs only linguistic validation, that's not that long. But still, you have to validate that questionnaire and use it. It depends on the time that you have and on your objective.
Thank you, madam.
Did I answer your question?
Yes, ma'am.
Then another problem that we come across when using this validated standardized questionnaires is that, as Sir and Madam discussed previously, they are actually the output of some validation studies that have been carried out by some other authors. So if we are going to use those questionnaires, we might not be able to freely just maybe download the questionnaire and use it in our own research. Therefore, I would like to ask, sir, is there any particular formal procedure that we have to follow when obtaining permission to use standardized questionnaires? And how would we know whether obtaining permission is necessary for a particular questionnaire?
Yeah, so the general idea is, if you are using a questionnaire that has been designed by somebody, now that particular questionnaire is that person's intellectual property. So never assume, although other researchers may have freely used it, maybe 10 or 15 or researchers, never assume that you can also use it. They may have obtained permission. So it is always good for you to find the original author of this particular questionnaire and at least drop them an email. I mean, there are certain questionnaires where the method of obtaining permission is very, very streamlined. They give you a website. You can go to the website. You are supposed to fill a form where they ask you who you are, why you want the questionnaire, for what purpose, what is the research objective. So there are questionnaires where the method of obtaining permission is very, very streamlined and very, very formal, right? Then there are other questionnaires where not so. You will have to dig up the literature, find out the original author, and write to the original author. That is why you have the address of correspondence in the articles. Now, in this particular study, I dug up the original author, wrote that author an email saying that we are planning to conduct this study and we want to use your particular questionnaire. Please give us permission. And then through email, the author replied, right? It will be a good idea to do this before you collect the data, right? Because at the end of the day, if that person says, no, you cannot use, you will be in a big soup. So when you are designing the study, even before you get ethics approval, one of the first things that you need to do is to write to that author and get the permission. Because we had a practical problem. I can remember when I was doing my PhD, one of the things that we want to do was to use one of these validated tools to assess patient compliance, right? And when we wrote to that author, we were asked to fill method of obtaining permission was very streamlined. We had to go to a website and fill that and so on. At the end of the day, that particular author wrote back to us saying, after filling all the forms and everything, that we have to pay to use the questionnaire, right? So keep this in mind, you need to get permission. So some people don't want you to use the intellectual property. And if you use and if you publish, they can always write to the journal editor and get your article kicked out. Even if it is published, the article can later be retracted or withdrawn if you have violated intellectual property. If you Google this and see, there will be many examples of this, right? So never use other people's intellectual property without proper permission.
Thank you very much. I think that is a very important piece of advice, especially about hitting. Maybe we might hit an unexpected paywall when trying to obtain permission. So we have to think of all those things before planning and getting on with the study. Then.
Yes, to add to that, Priyant, now one of my PhD students also, came across... she also wanted to use one of these standardized questionnaires. And the person wanted to be a co-author of her articles if we were to use this questionnaire. So actually, we didn't use it. So you can have these requests coming. Either you have to pay or you have to give authorship. So you have to be careful. I think you have to do this. Anyway, as Priyanka said, you have to get permission if you're using a questionnaire.
And I think I have also seen, for our own research that we did, we also sent a formal request and they said to cite one of the validation articles that they had written. So we had to cite that in our study. So I think that is
acceptable. That's something that you have to do. Yes, that's correct.
then we talked about linguistic validation previously. So then let's move on to study population. And to keep this discussion interactive, I would now like to ask someone from the audience, what is the study population that this study has been carried out in? I think we discussed it a lot now. So someone should, if you can unmute and answer. That again will be found in the methods section.
Yeah, may I?
Yeah, sure.
Here the study population is undergraduates from the Faculty of Medicine who have actually completed studying basic sciences.
Yes, so I think the people who have completed the basic science IBSS examination. So that population was selected and then they were followed up for a period of 5 years. Then another very important thing that we have to, I think, decide at the very onset of a study. And because if we ignore this fact, then at the end, when we sometimes might go to publish an article, then maybe from the peer review, then they might say that we need a comparison group. So whether or not our particular study needs a comparison group is a crucial thing that we as investigators should know. So sir, I would like to ask, how can we determine whether our particular study requires a comparison group? A comparison group in the sense, now here in this particular study, they have selected a population of medical students. A comparison group means usually of the same number, another group of students who are, maybe if we want to keep them similar, we can use another group of students, but who are not studying medicine. So how can we come to the decision whether or not we need a comparison group in order to satisfy the objectives of the study? Can you comment on that?
Yeah, so now the objective of this particular exercise was to see whether the students' emotional intelligence changes over time, right? Now, once you have established that it changes over time, then you can see what are the reasons. Is it just that people's emotional intelligence improves over time, or does the medical students' interactions with patients, their education, does it improve emotional intelligence, right? Now, to answer that question, when you use the study design like this, you have your limitations, because here we don't have a comparator group to say that. So we can jolly well say that the emotional intelligence improved, but whether that improvement was due to their education or the medical curriculum or interactions with patients or whatever, we can only postulate. We cannot say for sure. That is where in this design, where a comparator group would have been helpful. So that means we have medical students in one arm, and then we have maybe engineering students or whatever. We measure them at baseline and follow them up and see whether in which group the emotional intelligence improved. And if it is only in the medical group, we can postulate again, okay, then the medical group has something different to the engineering group, where the emotional intelligence has improved. Since they are from the same, let's assume we have recruited from the same age group, so then we can assume there's something different in the medical group that is contributing to the improvement in emotional intelligence. In this particular design, we cannot say that because we didn't have a comparator group like that. We can only postulate.
Thank you, sir. And then another question that I have is, if it is not possible to, maybe we might not always be feasible to have another comparison group, for example, maybe there might be resource limitations. For example, if our study was initially having 200 participants, then in order to have a comparison group, that would mean doubling the number. So we'll have 400 participants, and sometimes it might not be very easy to find a suitable comparative group. So in that case, madam, I would like to ask if it is not feasible to have a comparison group incorporated into our own study, is it possible to use secondary data from some other study that has been conducted in a different population as a comparison group for our study? Can we compare our results with that and then interpret the results?
Yeah,
Nadim, could you give your thoughts regarding like whether the secondary data can be used as a comparison group if it is not feasible to have a comparison group incorporated into our own study? Hello, Madam, I think.
Yeah, can I add to that?
Hello, sorry. Hello. I think I lost you all a bit. Can you repeat that?
Yes, Madam. So we were talking, Priyanka sir, as Priyanka sir said, sometimes we might need a comparison group in order to satisfy our objectives. But if it is not feasible to have a comparison group, is it possible to use secondary data from some other study as a comparison group for our findings and interpret our findings?
As you said, yes, ideal would be to have a comparison group because sometimes we need to control some of the factors. Let's say when you have two groups, like let's say in this study, if you get the same age group, same educational level, going through two different streams from same backgrounds, that would have been an ideal comparison group because you're controlling a lot of factors. Because what if you're looking at one variable or a few variables or even a score, there are so many factors which can affect that. So the reason to have a control group or a comparison group is to, we say to control the confounding factors to assess what you're looking for. So the ideal would be to have a comparison group. And I really don't, as a researcher, I don't advise using secondary data from another group. People have done that. Now, let's say if you have a group of medical students who have been studying on emotional intelligence, you can actually use data from another study and do an idea. You can get an idea as to whether there had been temporal changes if a similar follow-up study had been done, whether there had been temporal changes in both groups, and you can get an idea. So if it's also, again, based on what you're looking for, if you are to control all the, other factors, other confounding factors, ideal is to have a control comparison group. But if you want to... if you want to compare, then it's good to, it's okay to use secondary data as well. I'm losing you. Yeah.
Yes.
Were you able to hear me, Pian?
Yes, madam, we heard.
Thank you. So it's not, totally, unacceptable to use second data. People have used that and come up with, good theories and good findings. But if you're going to have a group, as I said, it's good to have a control group, then you're controlling a lot of factors.
Thank you, madam.
So in this study, so regarding the sample size calculation and regarding the sample selection. So here we have mentioned as medical undergraduates and we haven't specified whether it's Colombo or in Sri Lanka or like in the description of the topic. So how much is it okay for us to have a topic like this without mentioning a specified group since we are doing a convenient sampling in our study, selecting a particular batch from a particular faculty and mentioning it as a medical undergraduates?
Can I answer that?
Okay.
Now again, as you said correctly, this was more or less a convenient sample, at the end of the day, there was no sample size calculation as such done in this regards. When publishing, of course, it's up to you to decide. I understand that we could have said that this is in the Colombo faculty, but then why would we say that the Colombo graduates, why would we expect the Colombo graduates to be any different from any other graduate in Sri Lanka, right? So that is why, so in that sense, the results that are found, we can assume that the results that have been found in this study can be generalized to the other medical student population in Sri Lanka, because we are from the same social backgrounds and so on. It's an assumption only, right? So again, the problem of generalizability. So it is up to the authors to decide, do you want to say in the title or whatever that this was, I mean, the methods say that this is only in one university, but whether you want to say that in the title and the rest of the article, it is up to the authors to decide.
Okay, so thank you.
I think it's a good question, isn't it, Priyanka?
Yeah.
I think when you say medical students in the title, it's attractive. Rather, you know, when you mention a site, it becomes kind of restrictive. But it depends on the author as well as the reviewers and editors, if they're okay with the authors using it as a general title, then there's no issue. But if some reviewers, some editors would like the authors to highlight where it was done and sometimes may not allow that to be generalized. But it's just up to the journal authors and the reviewers. But if you want to think, or if you want to ask whether it's a good practice to mention the site, I mean, in your community medicine research, you've been advised to mention the site, the setting. It's good. It's good to, but when you go in a broader research publication field, you may not need to mention the site all the time because it only adds. What we say in the title is to have, we say title is vital because for people to search and find out, you have to have your keywords in the title and the setting may not be that helpful in that way. So it's not mandatory you have to have the title there, but you have to look in the discussion and the results whether when you are discussing whether your results can be generalized. If it cannot be generalized, you can mention that in the results. Okay.
Thank you, madam. Next, we'll move on to statistical analysis, and now we are running a bit short on time. So when looking at a paper, when studying a research, we should be able to, one of the most important things is to identify what the dependent variable and what the independent variables are. Usually in a study, there's only one dependent variable, maybe at the most there might be two, but there are a lot of independent variables, the effect of whose on the dependent variable is studied. So in this study, I would now quickly like to ask someone from the audience, what is the dependent variable that has been studied here and what are the independent variables? Would someone like to answer? What is the dependent variable? I think
hello, it's... Shall I answer that?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So in this study, our dependent variable has been the change in percentage of score of emotional intelligence in the students. And that's the independent variables we've had are the social demographic factors, whether they plan to do postgraduate studies or not, what their level of satisfaction is in their choice, also whether they do any extracurricular activities. Those are the variables that we've selected as the independent variables.
Thank you. So the main dependent variable here has been the level of emotional intelligence. Actually, since this is a follow-up study, the percentage change in emotional intelligence from baseline to follow-up has been the dependent variable in this study. And the several independent factors, independent variables, such as he mentioned, social demographic factors and several others have been studied. Then what are the statistical tests that have been used? Again, that is mentioned in the methodology section. Could someone answer that? The names of the tests? Because it's interesting.
The statistical tests have been used to achieve the objectives of the study. So the first objective was to assess the changes of emotional intelligence in our study population over the 5 years. So for this, what has been done is researchers have calculated the mean EI score at baseline and the mean EI score after follow-up after 5 years. And the researchers have compared the scores using, this appears to be a dependent sample t-test or a paired sample t-test because ideally the analysis is done on the same study population. On the same group of students. So, and they have, the researchers have shown that that there is a statistically significant increase of emotional intelligence. And this has been independently shown for both males and females as well. So that sort of fulfills the first objective. Second objective was to identify the correlates, and for that they have used like a chi-square test. So the percentage, like the percentage change of emotional intelligence, has been compared between the groups. However, only one, I think only one correlate was found to be statistically significant, and that was the satisfaction with chosen fields. So that was through the chi-square test. And finally, the significant associations were fitted into a final regression model. It appears to be a logistic regression model, but just to add a personal note, I wasn't really sure how this logistic regression analysis was conducted, because the researchers have not mentioned how like the dependent variable was was converted into a binary categorical variable. But yeah, those were the three tests. So paired sample t-test, chi-square test, and a binary logistic regression.
Thank you, Minru. So that is an important thing that we had to pay attention, whether the statistical tests that have been performed in a study actually satisfy the objectives that we started with. So as we mentioned, we know that there have been two main objectives, one to assess the change in emotional intelligence over time, and the next one is to identify the correlates. So to identify the change, just like Minru rightly mentioned, now in this table that I have taken from the article, here they have mentioned the emotional intelligence at baseline and then at follow-up. So these two values have been compared using a dependent sample t-test, because it's the same group that is being followed up. And then this difference was assessed for significance, and that is this p-value that is given here. So that satisfied the first test. And I see in the chat, Hans and I has also mentioned there's chi-square, t-test, and multiple regression analysis. Those are the tests that have been used here. Thank you. Then to satisfy the second objective, that is to identify the correlates of this change in emotional intelligence, the population has been actually divided into two based on, if you take gender, the change in emotional intelligence between males and females has been compared to see whether it's significant. And as Minru mentioned, only the satisfaction with the chosen field was found to be significant. Regarding the regression analysis, sir, would you like to give some brief comments on the regression analysis, since there are some doubts?
Yes, just to go through quickly the analysis part. Now, again, not related to this research, but one of the important things in research is that you collect the data in what you call the appropriate scales. Right now, for example, I have seen instances where people, now let's say the now not related to this project, but let's say somebody wanted to collect data on age, right? Now the particular data on age can be collected in multiple ways. Now you can ask the person what is your age so that they write down the age. You can ask the person their date of birth so that you calculate the age. You can ask the person to tick the age category, right? Now, when you are collecting data, one of the basic mistakes that I have seen people do, they collect these data in the scales and then come and ask us whether a particular analysis can be done. For example, let's say they collected the age as categorical variables. So they only collected the categories. So at the later stage, when they want to do a proper detailed analysis, that data is lost. They don't have the continuous data, right? So always remember, when you are collecting data, collect in the appropriate scales. I generally say as much as possible, collect in the continuous scale, even like things like family income, collect in continuous scale, because SPSS or whatever statistical software we use can easily categorize them later, right? But make sure you collect in the appropriate scales. That is number one. So when it comes to data analysis, there are two sets of analysis that happens in any research. The first set of analysis is known as univariate analysis, right? In univariate analysis, or you can call it bivariate also, because there are two variables involved. What you do is you are comparing one variable with the other, right? So you have an emotional intelligence change on one side, maybe compared with age. Emotional intelligence change on the other side, maybe compared with gender. right? All these are comparisons between two variables, right? The regression analysis takes this a little step further. Now, what happens in a regression analysis is something like this. Can I share my screen?
Yes, sir. Right.
Now, any decent journal will not accept research that doesn't have a regression analysis nowadays. Regression analysis is a bare minimum. I hope you can share this, see this particular diagram that I have shared. So a regression analysis is something like this. Now if you take a comparison between two variables, it is like y equals mx, what we have learned in school, right? Where you have the y, the x is the independent variable, and the m gives the strength. Now, you know, if you do a correlation, you get the Pearson's correlation value or the R value, right? So in the Y equals MX equation, M is the correlation value. That tells you how strongly that particular, the X and Y are related. The strength is shown by the M or the whatever the correlation coefficient. That is a univariate or a comparison between two variables. What happens in a regression is we input all the variables together. So you have an equation where y equals b1 x1, b2 x2, b3 x3, like that. You have several independent variables. So it is by using a regression analysis only you can say which variable is strongly associated depending on the beta values. So then you can compare the beta values. So for each variable, you will get beta 1, beta 2, beta 3, like that, several beta values will be there. Now you can say what is the variable. So all three variables may be significant, but using a regression only, you can say what is the stronger variable that is associated with the dependent variable. That is where a regression is necessary. You understand? So a simple correlation will only give a relationship between two variables, but you cannot compare one variable against the other. You cannot say age has a strong association with emotional intelligence than gender by using a bivariate analysis. That kind of answer can only be derived by doing a regression analysis. That is why you require regression. Do you understand?
Thank you, sir. And that is not something that is taught to us again in our undergraduate curriculum. So thank you for giving that very brief understanding about what regression is, so that maybe later on we can step by step learn more regarding that. Now let's move on to the final section of this journal club, that is how the results have been interpreted.
Can I just highlight one point? Can you go back to the previous diagram? So using the regression analysis, now let's say all these three variables, let's say all these were significant. Then only using the regression analysis, we can say what is the stronger variable. All may be significant, but what is the variable that is most strongly associated with change of emotional intelligence? That is the satisfaction.
Yes.
Right? That is what the value of a regression analysis. You can compare variables against each other.
So that we would be able to get a more holistic understanding about what's actually happening rather than comparing two variables at a time. Thank you, sir. So moving on to the results section. Now I'd like to ask someone to give what are the main findings? And we know what the objectives are. There are two main objectives. One was to assess the temporal change in emotional intelligence, and the other was to find the correlates of that change. Now I would like to ask someone to tell what the results that the investigators had found.
Thank you, Priyat. From the previous two slides, we can see that the emotional intelligence score has significantly increased over the follow-up period in all religion, ethnicity, and gender. And as Sir mentioned, the next important finding is the main factor associated with the rise of emotional intelligence is the satisfaction in choice of medical undergraduate studies.
Yes, thank you, Bharat. So based on the regression analysis also, and initially for the first objective, they have found that if you go to the results section, the initial paragraph, you can see this, that the mean emotional intelligence score had significantly increased from baseline to follow-up in both males and females, independently it was observed in both groups. So that is one finding. And they had the second objective was to assess the correlates of this change. And what they had found was that some independent variables such as social demography factors and gender, religion, all those factors were not actually very significant in determining this change in emotional intelligence. So what was the only factor that is found to be significant was whether or not the particular student satisfied with their chosen field of study. Now here at this point, I would like to pause a bit and look and try how to interpret these results. Can we establish a cause and effect relationship here based on the findings of the study? Now earlier at the beginning of the discussion, I said that this is a longitudinal study, and unlike a cross-sectional study, here we might be able to establish a cause and effect relationship. So the finding here was that satisfaction in the chosen field of study was a significant predictor. Based on that result, I would like to ask, sir, can we say that satisfaction in the particular field of study is the cause and the effect is the rise in emotional intelligence? Can we establish a cause and effect relationship like that based on these findings?
Yeah, so again, so the study is here to answer that question. The study design is appropriate, right? But what you have to go back and look now, this is an important thing. You may not be conducting research, but when you go to the hospital or when you go for higher studies abroad, you will be asked to critically review articles. Now, the emotional intelligence, you are satisfied that it was measured using a valid tool. Are you satisfied that the measurement of satisfaction was measured accurately? The answer to that my answer is it is not. Because satisfaction was simply measured by asking a yes-no question, right? But we know to measure satisfaction, it is again a construct that is similar to emotional intelligence. There are multiple facets, so you cannot gauge an accurate idea about satisfaction by a simple yes-no question. So the message here is, although the study design and everything may be appropriate to establish cause and effect relationship, not only for the dependent variable, even for independent variables, you have to see whether an accurate tool has been used, right? So that is a limitation in this study, right? But you need to learn to look whether the tools are accurate for all the variables that are measured. That is the message.
Thank you, sir. Then moving on. Finally, looking at the references section, there's one important thing that we have to look at here. An interesting thing is that even though the first author of this article is Professor Priyanga, here in the reference list also we see two papers that have been written in which the first author was also again Professor Priyanga. So here I would like to just briefly touch upon this concept on self-plagiarism, like whether it is essential to cite our own papers. So, sir, could you provide that brief description?
So plagiarism basically refers you where you take other people's content and publish or make use of it as your own, right? Now, in this regard, there is now self-citation and self-plagiarism are two things. Self-plagiarism means you take plagiarism is not accepted. When you are submitting an article to a journal, they will run it through a software and see whether you have taken directly from other authors without citing and without any modification, whether you have used other people's text. A certain degree, I mean, these softwares will come up with percentages. So then if there is highly plagiarized article, they will reject, right? Self-plagiarism means you are taking your own content and writing. Now, let's say I have published this same article Now, the original article, the first article that we did in this study, published somewhere in 2013-14. So I take content directly from that article, especially for the methods section, and I paste it in the methods section here. Nowadays, even self-plagiarism is not accepted. You cannot take your own published content and put it into the new article, even if it is your own content. So you need to modify it a little bit. Otherwise, journals will reject self-plagiarism. That is self-plagiarism. Self-citation is a different thing. So what has happened here is self-citation, where I have cited my own work, right? That is acceptable, again, provided that you are citing yourself to highlight a valid point in this article. If you are now, if I have cited all my research publications that are not related to this, like my publications on diabetes, my publications from the PhD or whatever, if I am inappropriately citing it here, that is not acceptable. But if you now, once you do start doing research on the same topic, you would have done many research. So self-citation is invariable. You will be citing your own work as you go along. That is accepted as long as you are citing what is relevant. Yes. Self-plagiarism nowadays not accepted. You cannot copy your own content to new articles. You will have to modify it, right? So those two things are different.
Thank you, sir. And then finally, before we wrap up our discussion today, I would like to talk a bit about the publication process, because most of us might be interested in that. What is the procedure for submitting an article to a journal, sir? Like most in this day and age, most of these activities are done online. So can you run us through the basic procedure for submitting an article to a journal and like dealing with peer review?
The most important thing is you need to go through the guidelines of the journal. So all the journals will give you what are their requirements. So fulfilling those requirements is the first step. Sometimes when those requirements are not fulfilled, the journals, some of them will reject the articles at the outset, right? Mm-hmm. So you need to make sure that you satisfy the journal's criteria or the journal's requirements. And nowadays, as you said, everything is online. So you need to go to the journal. They will have a portal for submission. You need to create your login and then follow the instructions where you... So different journals have different portals. So the data that you need to input are a little different. And then finally, you need to upload the relevant files. Some journals will want all the files in a single article or single Word document. Other journals will say, okay, we want the main article in one file. We want the tables separate. We want the figures separate. So that all depends on the journal that you are submitting. So you need to carefully go through the journal guidelines.
Thank you, sir. And finally, we have something that we encounter, especially being from a low-income country, is that there might be very huge article processing charges that we have to pay in order to publish our articles in a particular journal. So is there any way that we can maybe overcome, like, are there any procedures in which waivers may be given, or would the charge be different if we are publishing in an open access journal? Could you give your thoughts on that, sir?
Yeah, so this article processing charge is not there for all the journals, right? Article processing charge, now journals, there are two types. There are open access journals where the articles are freely available to everyone. Once it is published, it is open access. Anybody can go to the article, get the full paper. Then there are other journals which are subscription, where only the abstract may be seen to outsiders. You will have to pay and download the article. The article processing charge is there for open access journals, because other journals, they make money by giving subscriptions to the authors. So the idea here is the journals will also need some money to print and publish and maintain their website and do editorial work and so on. So the methods the two journals earn money are different. One set of journals earn money by subscription, so where the reader will have to pay. Other journals earn money where the authors will have to pay. So the article processing charges are there for these online open access journals, right? So now this particular journal that we have published, BMC Medical Education, is an open access journal. So that means an article processing charge is there, right? Which is generally very high. Now for this journal, I think the article processing charge is about $1,000, right? Fairly high amount for Sri Lanka. In other countries, the universities pay that amount and get the article published, provided you want to publish there, right? But most of these journals will give waivers. Now in this journal, we didn't pay the article processing charge. We wrote to them saying, look here, we have published this article. The original first paper was published in your journal. Now this is the follow-up. So we don't have any funding for this. We are from a developing country. So when you give a justification, most of the time they will give a waiver. The advantage of publishing in open access journal is that people see your article more often. So because it is freely available, so then your article is more likely to be cited. And your article is more likely to generate impact than if you publish in other journal, right? Article processing charges may be there, but you can get it waived off most of the time by writing a decent email and saying that you don't have enough funds.
Thank you, sir. I think that would be very important for, especially being student researchers, most of us would find it very difficult to afford these huge article processing charges. So we can, it is comforting to know that there are ways to overcome that barrier and publish in recognized journals. So that brings us to the end of today's journal club. And now it's a time for questions and answers. If you have any questions, you can either unmute yourself or you can put those questions in the chat box.
Yes, Priyat, I have a question, sir.
Yes.
Sir, in this research, so when we are assessing this emotional intelligence, so let's say if it's not a follow-up study and we are just getting a cross-sectional study, so then to tell or define that whether the emotional intelligence is good or bad, to develop a cutoff, if it is not available, is there any way for us to determine what is the cutoff value for good and bad, whether if we are using the same questionnaire with the cross-sectional study pattern, how to determine the cutoff, good and bad?
Now, as I explained earlier, when you say emotional intelligence, something like emotional intelligence, there is no, I wouldn't say there is any good or bad. It's a continuum. But I agree, certain things you might need to classify. Now we know IQ. If you take, you can say below this low IQ, above this high IQ, average IQ, so on. Emotional intelligence also, you can do that. There is something called the ROC curve analysis, which you can do, where you can identify the cutoff for this kind of continuous variable, where you can say above this it is good and below this it is bad. So that can be done.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Are there any other questions?
While waiting for questions, can I just concluding remarks? So
yes.
I'm very happy that you all did this. And in the future also, I will be available if you want my help, and I will share my contact details. You can, if you have any research questions, if you need any help in designing your studies, I am more than happy to help any student who is interested.
Thank you very much, sir. That is a huge support for us. I think even for this entire reason for creating this medical faculty research community was to provide a safe place for these young researchers to grow and learn about research methodology, I think. And providing, and for that, like in the earlier stages of doing research, we tend to make a lot of mistakes, and guidance from someone very mature and experienced in that field of research, such as yourself, would be very, very valuable for us. So thank you very much. So in the absence of further questions, let's wrap up today's sessions, and I would like to thank the panelists today, Professor Priyanka Ransing and Dr. Dilichandra Disanayake, for giving your time amidst your extremely busy schedules. And I think Professor Priyanka is joining us today from abroad. So even with that, Thank you very much for joining with us, and not just the knowledge that you imparted, that care that you show towards this project is extremely appreciated. So thank you very much. And for all the participants, thank you for joining today. Now this is a continuing process, so stay tuned for us and for future sessions as we discuss during this also regarding validation and on regarding how to write an article. So stay tuned for more. Thank you very much for joining us today. Have a good night.
Thank you to all of you, and excellent job. Well done.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.